worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Autumn forest in Denmark. As you see in the background, it starts to turn yellow and red. A very nice sight. Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air number 114 on contemplation of death and Buddhist parenthood and other issues. You are indeed welcome.
How is a bhikkhu moderately eating? While reflecting rationally, he eats food neither for the sake of entertainment, nor of infatuation, nor wishing for bodily beauty, but exclusively for the support and maintenance of this body, for ending discomfort and for assisting this noble life, considering, thus will I now end this old feeling of hunger, yet without arousing any new feeling of greed. Thus will I remain healthy, blameless, and in comfort, exactly as one treats an open wound, only for the purpose of healing it, or as one greases an axle only for the sake of easy transport of a heavy load. So does a bhikkhu, who is moderated in eating while always reflecting rationally, eat food. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on air number 114, recorded in October 2018 in the Danish autumn forest on a very nice, cool but clear and calm day. There are three questions, but first the normal intro. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha indeed. So before we start, I'd like to urge you on to click subscribe. This is a ticket to Nirvana, and if you have clicked subscribe, click the bell and leave the like if you like. There's also a small advertisement for a meditation course in North Carolina in December 2018. You see the Heartwood Retreat Center here, which is going to take place. It lasts 12 days, but you can participate as many days as you like. Just go to the link given below here in the video or in the video description or in the audio description, or go to whatbuddhasaid.net and click for meditation course. There are three questions as usual. And the first question goes like this. Question 351. A lot of questions we've taken so far. What is the importance of self-respect if Dhamma, if there is actually no self? Self-respect. Yes. I just like to say the opposite, self-depreciation, that one discuss oneself is usually the result of bad karma, of having lied or having stolen or having cheated or anything else, something like that. So this evaluation of the so-called self is highly dependable on the karmic background. And this means that if you do something bad, then you come to hate yourself. When you come to hate yourself, you also come to hate others and the world. If you do something good, then you come to be more lovable towards yourself and also towards others. So this is a first sign of evil karma in the background, is this self-appreciation, which is the opposite, or self-depreciation is the opposite of self-respect. But what if there actually is no self? There is a self in conventional sense, we say, samujisakya. But on the absolute level, then there is no self. If you should say what we mean by conventional self-respect is that they actually sees in this internal stream of consciousness a row of properties which we will describe like good qualities. These good qualities are mental states or positions in and by themselves. They are not owned by anyone or possessed by anyone or inside anyone. They are, can be internal or external, you say in others or in oneself, conventional self. But that's what they are. There are no self that have them as a container, inside a container, nor outside as a label, nor embedded always as a quality or property. They are just that in itself. And this is what we respect. We can respect if there is harmlessness in the consciousness, if this consciousness, stream of consciousness, takes up a principle of harmlessness, then we will usually respect that in ourselves and in others also. Same goes for honesty, determination, enthusiasm, generosity, wisdom, patience, endurance, calmness, forgiveness, focus, concentration, and integrity. All these egoless, ownerless qualities are what that is respectable and what it is, what is respected. If the same consciousness, same, there is no same, but nevertheless the same stream of consciousness suddenly displays anger in the next moment after having been harmless, then it neither respects itself nor do others respect this particular impersonal stream of consciousness. So it's the qualities that are respectable and that does, thus are respected, not a self. And the self does not contain them. Actually, usually they are, if we speak about harmlessness, for example, or honesty, then it's something that we share with each other and we infect each other with or condition each other with. So it's a shared property among many individuals that then take them up from time to time and then become respected because they take them up from time to time. And because it's difficult to maintain this principle in a world, an internal world and an external world that is colored by greed, hate and ignorance, then it's difficult to maintain these good qualities like honesty, modesty, integrity, harmlessness, and so forth. So it is impersonal qualities that are respectable and not a self. I hope this answered the questions. How to introduce is question 352. How to introduce children to Buddhism? Yes, I think actually the best nowadays is to see many of the good cartoons that are on YouTube, and you can also get them at Pariyatti, which is a Dhamma service lying in Canada, on the Buddha's life, and then meditate with them 20 minutes every day using hacky sacks. That is to say, a good way I use to, when I meditate with children, is that I introduce these hacky sacks, because then there's a kind of a competition. This is small balls of cloth with rice in, and then I myself sit like this, and they also should sit like this. And this silences them on the spot. And this can otherwise be difficult to silence children to sit still. One should not make the meditations too long. 20 minutes is on the long side. 15 minutes is okay. But then they gradually become disciplined. And when this is the case, then there will be no hyperactivity, attention deficit disorders, neither at home nor at school, no hyperactivity and a lack of discipline, as you see in a lot of Western countries, including Denmark, where lack of discipline in school is a major, major problem, actually. You almost doesn't see that in Asia yet, but in Europe you see it a lot, actually. So this is something that the family, of course, should take up, daily meditation, usually in the morning, but can also be in the afternoon, can also be in the evening, though it is a little more difficult in the evening. Then there's children books on Buddhism, also from Pariyatti. Some are free, some are not free, drawing books and so on. So to go back and go through the entire Buddha's life and all the life stories, for example, there's 547 Jataka stories of Buddha's former life, and they're very, very good to tell to children. They usually contain animals. There are also audios on these Jataka stories. They can also be gotten for free. Then there is bringing them to temple and talk with monks every Sunday. This is one of my duties at the moment, is to talk with children and teach them Buddhism every Sunday. This is fairly extensive on Sri Lanka, where they come 10 o'clock in the morning and go back 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So there are 6 hours in Dhamma school every Sunday. And this, I think, shaped them and disciplined them for life, actually. This embed them with what good properties and qualities are, and what is truth and what is right versus what is wrong and what is false. They have no discipline problems in school whatsoever, because I think of this training. So this is the way, actually. The earlier one starts, the better they get a handle on it, and they will take it on. Usually those who spread Dhamma today on a broad sense, they have been introduced to the Dhamma very early on. So some of the good monks from Sri Lanka, they were ordained when they were 11 or 15 or whatever, fairly early actually. So they have lived with the Dhamma when they come to teach themselves half a lifetime back, basically. And this of course gives some experience. And experience counts like nothing else. I think if meditation was introduced to all children and to all grown-ups also, I think it's not unrealistic that a major, major part of violence and conflict will be saved in the world. Because one immediately comes to know one's mind better, and an automatic self-purification process starts. And as we know from the Dhammapada, Buddhism can be explained or summarized in 3 lines. That is, to accept anything that is good, that is advantageous for all, and avoid anything that is bad, that is evil, that is detrimental for all, and then to purify our mind. This is the teaching of all the Buddhas, says the Dhammapada. So meditation and Dhamma study and discipline, this dual of mental training and discipline, gaining also insight that releases the mind, this, I think, could take something like 80% of all conflict and violence and dishonesty in the world. And at least it could, as a minimum, bare minimum, get the discipline and the calm back into the school classes, and also reduce the amount of stress in society significantly. Significantly. So I think it's coming. Basically, here in Denmark, it is coming. There's more and more meditation groups, usually arranged by lay people, two lay people, poor lay people, which I also participate in. And they are gaining a higher level of sophistication, I'll have to say. So even though there's no temples, there's a lot of lay activity on the meditation side, and also on the yoga side, which is somehow familiar to meditation. Question 353. Please explain about the technique of meditation on death. Is there any precautions when undertaken, and how often? I think the Buddha, he says that one should speculate about death every day, because it is the sure thing that one will die. And also it is one that holds on a lot of anxiety, because one doesn't know when. So it's like having a sword dangling above your head. You don't know when it will fall. And this plays a lot of insecurity in the mind. But if mind is not afraid of death because it has familiarized itself to death, then it is not afraid. And then also a lot of these anxieties that are smaller than the fear of death, which I think is the highest fear at the moment, then they will fall away. Because if you don't fear the highest, then neither do you fear something that is smaller than that. one should not undertake if severely depressed. But otherwise, if one has anxiety or is infatuated with one's own body or with sex, for example, or with youth or with one's looks and health, we say, we summarize this in Buddhism as this, this is an intoxication of youth, where one easily falls in love with this frame and think, this is everlasting. I have these abilities that this young frame has, this young body, and they will, I will keep them forever, and they are mine. And this infatuation, one has to relinquish gradually from the 30s and upwards. And it can be very painful. A losing battle, so to speak, in slow motion. This one, I don't see so much in the East where people are Buddhist, because they have contemplated this death all their life, because it's in a tradition. There's many ways to do it. I will read one aloud. The effect is fearlessness, because if you don't fear death, then you don't fear anything. It's absence of all anxiety, and it's death without panic. On the long run, one starts to think about more, okay, if I pass through death and there's reincarnation, then the goal of life become reformulated to what will happen after death? How can I assure with investment on this side of life that I'll not have a bad rebirth, a downfall into the fearful states of woe, the abhaya? Yes, then the meaning of life suddenly becomes reformulated to do something good and to avoid evil. So the contemplation of death automatically, inherently, in and by itself, make people better human beings. And so I think it's a small routine, a daily routine to contemplate this death. This is one of the 10 contemplations the Buddha say one should go through every day. The Buddha, the Dhamma, the Sangha, own morality, the morality of the devas, why did they become devas, fear of death, and so forth. These subjects one should turn over every day. The blessed Buddha once said, contemplation of death, bhikkhus and friends, when developed and frequently practiced, brings high reward and blessing, has a deathless dimension, nibbana itself, as a goal and sweet fruit. And how so, bhikkhus and friends? At every dawn and every dusk, the wise bhikkhu thinks to himself, there are many possibilities of dying. A snake may bite me, a scorpion, a centipede may sting me, and thereby I may lose my life. This would be an obstruction for reaching lasting happiness. Or I may stumble and fall, or I may become seriously sick, or bad men or evil spirits may attack me, and thereby I may die. That would indeed be for me an obstruction, blocking approach and thereby access to the deathless state of Nibbana. Here a bhikkhu therefore considers by intelligent reflection, are there still found in me evils, unsubdued evil and disadvantageous mental states, that if I should die tonight or today, would lead me to a bad, painful, low, ugly, poor or painful state? If there is so, then one stirs up urgency, samvega, and then with the utmost determination, energetic effort and endurance, steady awareness and clear comprehension, train to subdue, to silence these evil and disadvantageous mental states, such as greed, hate and ignorance, and various states mixed with these, such as jealousy, envy, irritation, stubbornness, rigidity, wrong views. If, however, the bhikkhu by reflection notices that there are not anymore found in him any evil and disadvantageous mental states, then such a bhikkhu can dwell in pure, blissful, serene joy, training himself in advantageous states both by day and by night. Anguttara Nikaya, Book 8, number 74. I made a special video on death contemplation, which contains all Buddha have said about it, and I include it right here.
Friends, death contemplation is daily Buddhist routine. The blessed Buddha once said about this. Bhikkhus and friends, contemplation on death, when developed and frequently practiced, brings high reward and blessing, has a deathless dimension itself, as gold and sweet fruit. And how so? Bhikkhus and friends, at every dawn and every dusk, the wise Bhikkhu thinks to himself, truly there are many possibilities of dying. A snake may bite me, or a scorpion, or a centipede may sting me, and thereby I may lose my life. This would be an obstruction for reaching lasting happiness. Or I may stumble and fall down, or I may become seriously sick, or bad men or evil spirits may attack me, and thereby I may die. That would indeed be for me an obstruction, blocking approach, and access to the deathless state of Nibbana. Here, a bhikkhu therefore considers by intelligent reflection, are there still found in me unsubdued and evil disadvantageous mental states, that if I should die today or tonight, would lead me to a bad, painful, low, ugly, poor, painful, or unsuccessful next life? Now, if he by such reflection realize that indeed still are unsubdued, evil, and detrimental mental states found in him, then he should use his utmost determination, energetic effort, endurance, steady awareness, and clear comprehension in order to subdue these evil and disadvantageous mental states. If, however, the bhikkhu by reflection notices that are not anymore found in him any evil and disadvantageous mental states, then such bhikkhu can dwell in pure, blissful, serene joy, training himself in advantageous things and states, both by day and by night. Source: Anguttara Nikaya, 874. Friends, the thorn that is life is that it is short, difficult, unknown, yet surely lethal. The problem of life is thus this assured, an inevitable death. Friends, remembering this death as daily Buddhist routine, the blessed Buddha once said about this, just as a mighty Himalayan mountain are high or expensive and weighing heavily, just so do aging and death suppress and defeat all beings in this fragile world. Whether divine, rich, warrior, priest, trader, slave or sweeper, not sparing anyone, whosoever, crushing anybody that is found. This is the most precious altar in our temple, this body that dies. Soon this fragile body will fall to the ground, lifeless, cast aside, unconscious, stiff, cold, and useless like a rotten log of wood. Momentary. Whosoever knows his body to be as temporary as a bubble, as insubstantial as a mirror image, make break Mara's honey-tipped arrows, and can thus not be seen by this evil king of death. Big surprise! Death carries off the folly man while he's still distracted by gathering various flowers of sensual pleasures. Even so, as a huge tsunami ray runs all over and carries away the sleeping village. In the ultimate sense, beings have only a very short moment to live, only as long as one single moment of consciousness lasts. Just as the cartwheel is rolling forward, as in standing still, in every moment rest merely on one point of its rim. Just so does any life of any being last only one single moment of consciousness itself. As soon as this moment is gone, that momentary being is also all gone. One is therefore reborn millions of times in each second, for as it was said by the ancient elders. All life and all existence here is blinking and momentary. All is life engaged involvements, all its joys, dramas, and all its pains depend only on one single, discrete, ever-passing state of mind. And quickly that moment passes by, for never ever to return again. None and nothing is worth clinging to, since it's game over ever and ever and ever again. The Blessed Buddha once said, the days and nights are flying past. Life dwindles hurriedly away. It ticks away. The life of mortals vanishes like water flushes out a tiny stream. Certain future fall. As in the morning one may fear the falling of all the ripened fruits, so do all mortals in this world live in constant fear of death, since they know certain is their future death. Crack up, clay pot. All beings are subject to death, and in death can never escape death. As every earthenware pot fashioned by the potter's hand, no matter whether small or great, they will fall and break to pieces in the end. All these clay pots and bodies. Just so are all beings subject to death, end in death, and can never escape death. All beings will have to die. Their life will one day end in death. And they will fare according to their doings. The good and bad fruits they have earned and accumulated. The evildoer fares to hell. The nobleman re-arises in a happy world. Hence noble doings you should perform as a safe provision for your next life. For good doings for the next world, give to all beings their only support on the other side. On the other side. On the other side. One should often contemplate this inevitable fact of death. Why actually doing this? Because this makes one approach Nibbana, the only deathless destination. Neglecting thinking about death makes one accumulate future rebirth, and therefore also future rounds of aging, decay, sickness, and death. This is us only suffering. Considering death repeatedly is therefore quite advantageous, but initially not exactly pleasant. Death contemplation gradually gives fearlessness of death, and thereby evaporate all other anxieties. Neglecting death contemplation is therefore detrimental, though more dull and pleasant, just like if one is anesthetized. This fact remains. One loses all again and again at the moment of death, including this body. Death itself is painless and should not be feared. It is life itself that is painful and dreadful and thus should be feared. The only way to escape this life and death cycle is not to be reborn. Only that is peace. Only this is freedom from all future suffering. Only this is the end of all pain. Only such final cessation of samsara is in itself irreversible, lasting happiness. As the Buddha Gautama said, Nibbana Paranang Sukham. Nibbana is the highest bliss. This noble way is therefore about stopping the spin just like the plane spinning down, crashing. It is stopping this spin of aging, sickness and death. The noble way is about end-making. Ignorance leads to karma. Karma leads to rebirth, aging, sickness and death. Understanding of the Four Noble Truths ends karma. Ending karma ends rebirth, aging, sickness and death. And thus ends all suffering. The Blessed Buddha once pointed out, the life of mortals here is difficult, brief, unknown, without guarantees, and is always joined with the inherent misery of aging, decay, sickness and death. For there is no chance, no possibility that one born will not die. To die is the nature of all beings. Just as the ripe fruit, there is constantly a fear of falling. Even so do all beings also constantly fear death. Just as clay pots all break up sooner or later, even so is the life of all mortals. Whether young or old, foolish or wise, all of them, will surely die. When they are overcome by death, going from here to the next existence, no one, neither father, son or family, can protect the mortal who is led away like the cow to be slaughtered. And that even while the wailing relatives are actually looking on. The world is irreversibly infected by death, sickness and old age. Knowing this as an unavoidable absolute, wise men do not grieve, but accept this very fact just as it is. Lamenting over a mortal is gone, has died, is utterly useless. Whose past one cannot know, seeing neither from where he came nor where he is going, cannot be helped by any moaning, crying, or lamenting. All wise can realize that lamentation just harms oneself. This sorrow serves no good purpose. All this is true, whether it's oneself or another who's dying. Weeping won't help. Friends, anybody is a dying bag of bones. All formations, all constructions, mental as physical, are truly transient. It is their very nature to arise and cease right there where they arose. Having arisen, these captivating, discreet mental states instantly pass away right there. The calming, stilling, and ceasing of these momentary appearances is happiness. Therefore, even in the present, every being dies millions of times per second. So also will they die in any possible future, and so have they always died. In the same way then, I shall surely die. There's no doubt about this in me. Uncertain is life, but certain is death. I shall surely die. Death will be the termination of my life. Life is very insecure, but death is sure. Death is certain. Not long, alas, this my beloved puppet-like body will lie as frozen upon the earth, rejected, smelling, void of consciousness, disgusting as a useless, rotten log of wood. This very body, from the skin
soles of the feet to the crown of the head is just a bag of bones surrounded by skin, full of various meaningful impurities, such as head hair, body hair, nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bones, marrows, kidney, heart, liver, membranes, spleen, lungs, bowel, intestines, slime, excrement, brain, bile, lymph, pus, blood, sweat, fat, tears, tallow, spit, snot, joint fluid, and stinking urine. Just a bag of bones, flesh, and skin. A rotten heap of suffering. A rotten heap of suffering. Keeping this precious and very realistic imagery in mind, we then gradually reduce and weaken these violent lusts and voracious greeds and uncontrollable wandering desires that attract beings into self-destructive forms of suffering, such as pornomania, pedophilia, HIV-transmitting sexuality, overeating, abuse of drugs, alcohols and pills, all addictions to the manifold and diverse forms, feelings, perceptions, mental constructions, and variants of doped consciousness. All this, though fascinating, remains just an ensnaring, enthralling suffering, disguised as pleasure and satisfaction. Friends, aging reproduces the same suffering ever and ever again. Aging is suffering. And what is aging? Whatever decay, decrepitude, broken teeth, graying of hair, wrinkling of skin, decline of strength, weakening of the mental abilities, feebleness and senility of whatever kind of being that is called aging. Its function is to lead on to death. It is manifested as the vanishing of youth. It is suffering because of the change into decay and the gradual but steadily falling apart of the body, the loss of memory and intelligence into senile dementia. It's distressing. Malignness in every limb, with every ability declining, with vanishing of youthfulness, with memory all evaporated, with intelligence eroded away, with strength now drained, with growing unattractiveness, now looking and smelling bad to both wife, friends and family. This is an unavoidable misery any mortal must expect to find. Since aging is what all this will bring, aging is well designated as suffering. Friends, the inevitable and ever-returning problem, death. All health ends in sickness. All youth ends in aging. All life ends in assured death. All worldly beings begin with birth, is haunted by aging, surprised by sickness, and struck down by death, often in a state of desperate panic and frantic fear. How short is this life? You die on this side of a century, but even if you live more than 100 years, you die of old age. Aging and death is thus an ever-recurring, nasty surprise for anyone who habitually lives in complacency. For anyone who habitually lives in complacency. Death carries off the man while he is still distracted by gathering flowers of sensual pleasures. Death sweeps away the man distracted while he not yet had his fill of sensual pleasures. even as he gathers these flowers. Exactly as a cowherd drives the cows forward, exactly and even so do aging, sickness and death drive all beings towards the end. But those who listen and act accordingly, when the depth of the Dhamma is revealed, they indeed cross beyond this realm of death, so hard to overcome. Neither in the distant space, nor in the deepest ocean, nor in the darkest cave can anyone escape this crushing fact of death. The man who understands his inevitable death, if clever, lives morally pure, while keenly clearing this great urge, his path to Nirvana approaches. This body is always worn out, a fragile form, a nest of disease, a rotting mass of deception, since his life surely and always ends in decay and death. A bag of bones, like withered leaves scattered by the autumn wind. Are these pale and whitened bones? What happiness can there ever be in them? My precious and adored body. It is a bag held off by bones, plastered with skin, full of blood and flesh. In it lives only aging, sickness, death, pride, and pity, self-deceit. The Blessed Buddha once said, while alive, then he's untroubled, and when he dies too, then he's not worried. A recluse who has seen the goal lives undisturbed, even in this sorrowful world. Wherever he goes, there he's unafraid. Wherever he sleeps, there he's unalarmed. The nights and days does neither touch nor burn him. He sees nothing in this world that is to be kept or lost. Therefore his mind dwells in goodwill and gentle kindness to all beings until he falls asleep. Here he rejoices, so after death he rejoices. The one having done good works rejoices both places. Remembering, looking back, seeing and thinking, oh, I have done good works, well done. He enjoys the bliss of the happy worlds even more. Whoever never injures with weapon or stick, being searching for the happiness when after this death, seeking the same happiness, such clever and kind one, always find it. The friend who returns from a long journey is welcomed back by his family and friends. Even and exactly so when the doer of good at death passes to the next state, then his merits receives him, awaits him, like friends and family. The homeless sages, always restrained in both action and body, finally pass to the deathless state, where sorrow is not. Having so gone to the far shore of being, mind is freed from all attachment, from any substrate of existence, and never returns to birth, aging, or death. The one who has no longings, who fully understands, who is without doubt, who is established, immersed in the deathless state, such one I call a holy one. Thank you.
Now we've gone through this death contemplation, Marana Anusati. It is time to end this video. So I will say thanks to all Dayakas supporters, especially the monthly regular donors. And then I will say have a nice and noble day. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa, worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened, was the blessed Buddha. Thank you.
How is a bhikkhu moderately eating? While reflecting rationally, he eats food neither for the sake of entertainment, nor of infatuation, nor wishing for bodily beauty, but exclusively for the support and maintenance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting this noble life, considering, thus will I now end this old feeling of hunger, yet without arousing any new feeling of greed. Thus will I remain healthy, blameless, and in comfort, exactly as one treats an open wound, only for the purpose of healing it, or as one greases an axle only for the sake of easy transport of a heavy load. So does a bhikkhu who is moderated in eating while always reflecting rationally eat food. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Bambarella, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.